Well, tonight we approach one of the most well-known sections of the entire Bible, Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. And some commentators have written that there are 35 different ways to interpret the Sermon on the Mount. And don't worry, I'm not going to rehearse all of those. From my meditation, I think the Sermon on the Mount is forcing us to wrestle with one simple question, one clear question that I think opens up the Sermon on the Mount for us in a way that allows us to access what Jesus is really getting at. And the question is, how will you respond to the wickedness in the world? How will you respond to the wickedness in the world? When you look around at the moral darkness alive in individuals, corporations of all kinds, how will you respond? When a situation lacks peace, will you be a peacemaker? When you assess your own internal morality, will you be self-righteous? When you are tempted to judge someone's heart, will you give in? Will you engage in hypocrisy? In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus holds up the wickedness of the world and he doesn't blink. He says to his disciples, here is how you respond. That's the essence of the Sermon on the Mount, how you respond to the reality of wickedness in the world. Now, so far in the book of Matthew, Jesus has been fulfilling one Old Testament theme after another. Now, some of you have heard all of this already, but allow me to rehearse it. Matthew tells us right away that Jesus is the true and better son of David in the introduction, when he calls him the son of Abraham, the son of David. He tells us in chapter 2 that he's, in chapter 1 later, that he is Emmanuel, God with us, the one who will lead God's people out of exile. He tells us he is the servant of the Lord from Isaiah 42 through 53, the one who was set apart to suffer for the people. He tells us, that is, Matthew tells us that Jesus is the faithful Israelite who comes out of Egypt and keeps the covenant. And because of all this, as we saw last week, Jesus is able to push back the consequences of the curse. Jesus has been faithful to the covenant and is therefore able to push back the consequences of the curse, which was our immediate section before this, where Jesus is going around healing people and the crowds are coming to him. Now, this is just a portion of the Old Testament themes that Matthew has introduced. And now we get to the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus has been healing, as I said, and preaching and teaching, and he has attracted a massive crowd. They love the supernatural power that's flowing from him and healing people and curing them of all sorts of diseases, all sorts of afflictions. But Jesus has a bigger agenda than attracting a crowd. As we learn from Matthew 1, Jesus has come to rule and bless the nations in God's new creation. Jesus has come to rule and bless the nations in God's new creation. And this is the focus of the Beatitudes, which of course is our focus tonight. The Beatitudes is what this section of Scripture is called, where the blessings are given. Now in the Beatitudes, which is Matthew 5, 3 through 12, Jesus has a royal agenda, a royal agenda. And this section begins and ends focused on the kingdom of God. So if you still have your Bible open, look at verse 3. It says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And then look at the last beatitude, which is in verse 10. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of heaven frames the section that we're focused on today. Jesus' royal agenda has been clear for two chapters now, or you might even say from the beginning. John the Baptist says, repent, the kingdom of heaven is at hand, in chapter 3. Then in chapter 4, the devil tempts him by offering to him all the kingdoms of the world. But later in chapter 4, Jesus himself repeats the phrase of John the Baptist, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. So the royal agenda is so prevalent that the whole book of Matthew begins focused on King David, as I've already said, and it ends with Jesus saying, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Jesus is the king. You could say that's the summary of the book of Matthew. Now, to drive this point home even further, the kingdom is referred to in the Sermon on the Mount 6 more times after our section. In chapters 5 through 7, the kingdom is referred to 6 more times. Jesus has a royal agenda, and his royal agenda is how he wants us, his disciples, people who hear his words, to answer the question, how will you respond to the wickedness in the world? Now, before we continue, we have to acknowledge that as Americans, or at least people living in America, that we're at a great disadvantage when it comes to understanding kings and kingdoms. We can't even ask Liam anymore. He's no longer a British citizen. Because we said we didn't want a king originally, we now think of kings and queens and kingdoms as metaphors to entertain us. I'm not going to do a show of hands, but whether it's through Disney or The Crown or just following the lives of the royal family, Harry, Meghan, some of you are enthralled with, we love the idea of kings and queens and kingdoms, but we don't understand them. So it's hard for us to access the primary metaphor Jesus uses to help us understand the way he operates. I was once in Scotland, and there was this big parade of cars coming by, and I went over to see what it was. Apparently the queen was in the area. So I went up to one of the policemen. I said, hey, what's the queen doing here? He said, what does the queen do anywhere? I just walked away. I didn't know what to say. I still don't understand kings and queens, even when I asked. So our imaginations need to be stirred a bit for this metaphor, Jesus' primary metaphor in the book of Matthew. For it to work, we're going to have to access this metaphor in a way that might feel a little artificial for us. Now, when we think of kingdoms, people who exert control, kingdoms, places where control is felt, we could start to think of things like Facebook. They are always controlling us, you might say, modifying the way we view community and 100 other things, things we don't even know about. Or you might think of Apple, the fact that they are always listening. Hopefully they're listening to my sermon right now. In some form or another through our phones. Or maybe you think of the NFL. It's certainly a kingdom. They own an entire day of the week for half the year. Now, these are all somewhat ominous. You know, we don't like these illustrations because they make us feel like we're being encroached on. That's the reality of what kingdoms are. So I've chosen a little happier one for us to really meditate on as we think about the reality of a kingdom, because not because it's fun, but because that's the primary metaphor Jesus is using to help us understand the Beatitudes. The primary metaphor that Matthew uses over and over again in the book of Matthew is the idea of kings and kingdoms. So the kingdom that we're going to meditate on briefly, just to stir our imaginations, is Chick-fil-A. Yes, I know this is church. That's so predictable that we'd choose Chick-fil-A, but I think it's worth meditating on briefly. And the Cathay family has managed to create a completely uniform product wherever you go, which has engaged every sensory experience you can think of. We all know the red and white signs of Chick-fil-A. We all know when someone says, my pleasure, we're in Chick-fil-A. We all know that the instrumental Christian music that we hear in Chick-fil-A is kind of comforting, even though it's bad. We are probably at Chick-fil-A whenever we have a waffle fry. And they managed to make sure people never work on Sunday. Now, if you've never been to Chick-fil-A, you should go. You should go this week. But I heard one time that a Chick-fil-A did open on Sunday. Everyone's like, what? It's terrifying. It is terrifying. This is a kingdom. They exert control. This is not supposed to happen. So apparently the owner of Chick-fil-A, the founder, Dan Cathay, got in a plane, flew to that Chick-fil-A, walked into the mall in Arizona and said, shut this store down right now. He fired the manager and he promoted the assistant manager. He said, shut the store down. Well, that's the way a kingdom operates. Now, hopefully, you can forget about Chick-fil-A long enough to come back to the sermon. But I think it is the clearest and most wholesome example of a kingdom that at least we can think of. They have so commanded the behavior of people in the kingdom, they dictate what words people are allowed to say. They have total control of behavior. When we think of kingdoms as Americans, we think of Disney princesses or The Crown, some TV shows, but real kingdoms in this world function on control and uniformity. They function on power. They function on agendas. That's the way kingdoms work. They exert control. They exert uniformity so that people know what's going on in the kingdom, and they know how to submit to that kingdom. Well, Jesus himself has a royal agenda. But Jesus' royal agenda is completely different from any kingdom that we could ever fathom, real or imagined. In Jesus' kingdom, he will have our obedience. He will have our uniformity. He will have our conformity to his word. We will submit to King Jesus. But as is the case in all the kingdoms of the world, kings want that whether they have the people's heart or not. They would think it's nice to have the people's heart. They would love to know that their people love them. But Jesus will not exchange obedience for our hearts. He's coming for our hearts, our souls, our minds, and our strengths. He wants all of us, not just our ability to say, my pleasure. Jesus is after our hearts, and that's ultimately what the Sermon on the Mount is about. This is ultimately not a kingdom about behavior modification. Jesus' royal agenda is way bigger than that. So I'm going to use the phrase royal over and over again for the rest of this sermon. What I want you to think of is Jesus' royal agenda to go for people's hearts and minds and their strength. He wants all of you. He won't exchange mere conformity to a set of rules for your heart. He won't exchange some lip service for your praise. He wants all of us. That's what this sermon, that's what this passage of scripture is ultimately about. So when I see the word, when I say the word royal, I want you to think of Jesus going for your obedience, yes, but his agenda is to have our obedience by having our hearts. That's the focus of the passage tonight. Now, the royal agenda in this passage, the Beatitudes, can be framed in three ways. In verses 3-5, Jesus focuses on the royal family. The royal family. People who Jesus has their hearts. The royal family. Then, in 6-9, he articulates the royal calling. What is it that these people are supposed to do? And then finally, in 10-12, he warns about the royal persecution which inevitably will follow when people give their hearts and their actions to Jesus. So, to repeat it, we have the royal family in 3-5, the royal calling in 6-9, and then in 10-12, the royal persecution. Now, I wanted us to have the structure of 3-12 in our minds as we begin to see it is focused on Jesus's royal blessing, but tonight we're only gonna focus on 3-5, the royal family. Lord willing, over the next 2 weeks, we will meditate on the second two parts of the Beatitudes. Now, to start our analysis, we have to ask a question about genre, or what type of speech is this? The question ultimately is, what is a beatitude? What is a beatitude? We don't speak in beatitudes in our normal speech. We don't say to people, blessed are you, such and such, because of this. We don't use that sort of language. So, we have to understand what it is. And verses 1 and 2 give us some hints. Jesus is teaching the disciples. Jesus is teaching the disciples, it tells us in verses 1 and 2. And the way he teaches them is by speaking these wisdom sayings, these proverbs, you might say. Sometimes Jesus uses parables, as we'll see later in the book of Matthew. Sometimes he preaches sermons. But here he is teaching them through a wisdom saying, kind of like a proverb, calling a beatitude called a beatitude, which in Matthew consists of three parts. A beatitude in Matthew consists of three parts. In each verse, Jesus leads the beatitude, emphasizing God's grace for people to enjoy. He leads each beatitude, emphasizing God's grace for his royal family to enjoy through the word blessing. Then he articulates God's standard for people to pursue, a standard for his people to pursue. And then finally, he offers God's promises for people to believe. Every beatitude in this section has those three parts: grace to enjoy, a standard to pursue, and then a promise to believe. Now let's begin looking at verse 3. I don't know if you have experienced this, but there are few feelings worse. I think we've all been there. Than going to an ATM and trying to get some money out, and you get some money out and gives you the option to find out how much money is in your account. So it prints out the little receipt, and you look at And you start thinking, this is way lower than I thought it would be. Did someone steal from me? Did I go on a spending spree last night? Did I tithe too much? What happened? You're sitting there looking at this receipt. You look at your account and you realize you're broke. This is a jarring experience. Maybe you've never experienced it, but it's not pleasant. The members of Jesus' royal family are people who look at their spiritual condition, just like we all check our financial accounts, and consider themselves poor. Through the metaphor of poverty, Jesus describes the state of his family members, that is his royal family, his family members' spiritual condition. A person who receives the grace of God's blessing, which is how each beatitude starts, and the promise of God's heavenly kingdom, which is how verse 3 ends, is someone who assesses their own spiritual state and concludes, I'm morally broke. So the first way Jesus wants us to respond to the wickedness in the world, right? That's the way we're framing the Sermon on the Mount. How are we going to respond to the wickedness in the world? Based on verse 3, it's to recognize that we contribute to it. This is how you receive God's blessing. You recognize you don't deserve God's blessing. This is how you receive God's grace, the grace of his presence. You acknowledge that you are in need of his grace. A member of Jesus' royal family is someone who is honest enough with their heart to conclude, I am poor in spirit. I am morally bankrupt. This is the first requirement of somebody who is going to be on Jesus' royal agenda because he's going after our hearts. Remember, the standard to pursue someone who is poor in spirit is only the middle portion of the verse. It's only the middle portion of the verse. The first part is a declaration of grace to enjoy. The blessing declaration is a declaration of grace to enjoy. God's presence is being declared to you. Jesus, God himself, Emmanuel, is declaring the presence of God through the blessing. And then he attaches a promise to it. Now, someone in Jesus' royal family has heard Jesus say, because I kept the covenant on your behalf. This is Jesus speaking to all of us who have repented, who have declared that we're spiritually broke. Jesus has said, I kept the covenant on your behalf. You are blessed. That's the grace. And you are a part of God's kingdom. That's the promise. The kingdom of heaven is yours. The way we respond to wickedness in the world is to look inwardly because Jesus' agenda, his royal agenda, is for our hearts, and we realize we contribute to the wickedness through our thoughts, our ideas, our motives, and our actions. Now, every family has standards. The standard to pursue if you are a part of Jesus' royal family is to acknowledge you're spiritually bankrupt. Once you come to that conclusion, Jesus makes you a promise. You are now in the kingdom of heaven. You are under God's gracious rule. You have repented your way into his presence. You have received the grace of his righteousness, and you have repented your way into the light. Oh, our instinct with the question, how do we respond to the wickedness in the world, is to look elsewhere, to try and find a solution for the problems that we see. And that's a good instinct. Jesus wants you to do that. But that's next week's sermon, the royal calling of the royal family. But if we in any way want to be on Jesus' agenda, if we in any way want to be a part of the solution, you have to look inward first and conclude, I'm spiritually broke. Because Jesus is coming for our hearts, our souls, our minds, and our strength. Now, practically, and this is somewhat abstract, but if we think practically, how do we make that sort of assessment? How do I know if Jesus has my heart? How do I know if I've truly repented? How do I know if I've looked at my moral account and decided I am poor in spirit? Well, I think you just read the rest of the Sermon on the Mount. You look at verse 5:21. You think murder is against the law? Jesus says anger is against the law. Or you look at 5:27. You think adultery is against the law? Jesus says lust in your heart is against the law. You think you should love your neighbor? That's very good. Jesus says you should love your enemy. And this is just chapter 5. Jesus is helping us to see just how poor we truly are in our spirits. He's helping us to see how high the standard is so that we can truly see our state. He is not a doctor who gives us the wrong diagnosis. He is showing us that we truly are poor in spirit. And Jesus doesn't want you to do all of that introspection that I just described to become introspective. That's not the end result. He doesn't want us to just be focused on our performance. He wants you to see the poverty in your spiritual life so that you look up to him and hear him declare you blessed. And when you repent, you receive the blessing of God. When you look to Jesus, aware of your spiritual poverty, he promises you are a part of his heavenly kingdom. So in this first beatitude, and really in the entire Sermon on the Mount, Jesus is going for our hearts. That's his royal agenda. He came so that he might speak grace to you when you become aware of your spiritual poverty. He conquered Satan in the wilderness and fulfilled the covenant so that he might offer you the blessing which only he deserves. As Sinclair Ferguson put it, the blessing is simply fellowship with God, the experience of covenant promise. Well, let's go to the second beatitude, verse 4. Jesus wanted us to look inward in verse 3, but now he wants us to both look inward and to look at the world. See, the reality of the standard of Jesus's royal family is that when they look at the wickedness in the world, they mourn. The people who are a part of God's royal family, the people who are going to receive God's blessing, the fellowship of his presence, that's what his blessing is, which this time comes in the form of comfort, are those who look at the wickedness and injustice in the world and they mourn. Now, you don't have to live too long to know what it means to mourn. It includes the longing for the presence of a friend. Many of you are mourning the loss of a friend. It includes the sadness which comes when someone breaks your trust and you miss the intimacy of that relationship and you know you shouldn't trust them anymore. It includes the grief which enters the moment you hear a family member is dying. It includes looking at an opportunity that you yourself wasted and mourning that missed chance. Mourning comes in a variety of ways, but the long and short of it is that you know things are not the way they should be. And when you look at the world on Jesus' royal agenda, you mourn the absence of justice, the presence of sickness and corruption, the absence of true sacrificial leadership, the presence of the abuse of power. You mourn all of this, and you know you yourself are spiritually poor, so you contribute to it. And the appropriate response is to mourn and look to the one speaking blessing to you. When you mourn, you cannot mourn, as I said, destitute, introspective only. No, you mourn as someone looking to Jesus, the one who is pushing back the curse, the one who is binding up the brokenhearted, the one who is proclaiming liberty to the captives. When you look up to the one declaring God's blessing, you see the one who has wept himself when his friends die, who has been disappointed by his other friends when they abandon him. This is what it means to be in the royal family. Jesus says, when you do this, you have already received the blessing of God's presence in your life. When you do this, you are already experiencing his comfort. The reason Jesus establishes this standard for us is to orient our emotions to the very heart of God. When we mourn the reality of the world, we are more awakened to the comfort which his presence brings. And the blessing, as I said, is being restored to relationship with him. Now, this is not a trick. The world is worth mourning over. When you look at it, you should mourn. But you should also look to God, the one in whom there is nothing to mourn over, the one in whom all perfection and beauty and righteousness dwells, the one in whom Jesus perfectly demonstrates through his treatment of all different types of people. When you contemplate God, you are contemplating his perfection, all of his attributes summarized as blessed. And this, when you look at it, most clearly demonstrated on the cross, brings comfort. So we've seen that Jesus' royal family looks inward and realizes they are spiritually poor. They look inward, but they also look outward and they mourn the state of the world. And then finally, they are unafraid to make this reality public. Verse 5, they are meek. They are meek. Now, meekness is incredibly difficult to describe, but I think Don Carson summarizes it best. He says, we may acknowledge our own bankruptcy, as demonstrated in verse 3. And we may mourn the state of the world and our contribution to it, verse 4. But to respond with meekness when others tell us of our bankruptcy is far harder. Meekness, therefore, requires such a true view about ourselves as we will express itself even in our attitude toward others. Meekness is agreeing with people when they mourn over your sin. When people see the sin in my life and they mourn over it, if I am being meek, do not get defensive. But because I have assessed my heart and have concluded that I am poor in spirit, to be meek is to watch someone mourn over my sin and to agree with them. Now, this beatitude, this last one, to refresh our memory, has three parts, just as the other two. The grace to be enjoyed, that is the blessing, the restoration of our fellowship with God. The standard to pursue, that is meekness. And the promise to believe. The promise here being that we will inherit the earth. Now, this is an incredibly paradoxical promise. Jesus has just talked about our willingness to be open about the fact that we are sinners. No, he doesn't mean that we need to tell everybody about our sin. He doesn't mean that we need to somehow flaunt it. He doesn't mean that we need to somehow air out our dirty laundry. That is not what he means. But he does mean that when people know our sin, that we would not deny it to their face. That what we would say to God about ourselves, we would be willing to say to somebody else. We wouldn't be ashamed of them knowing that we are poor in spirit. That public reality of this standard is accompanied by a public promise that we will inherit the earth. Now, going back to our initial illustration, if you want to start a Chick-fil-A franchise, you just have to get a job at Chick-fil-A and be a really good employee for a really long time. And then eventually, they'll allow you to start a franchise. But there is no way to be a grandchild or a great-grandchild of the founder. You cannot become, all of a sudden, one of the founder's children. You cannot become a part of the family. Of course, yes, you can marry into it, but you get my point. Jesus is saying that the meek inherit the earth. Who gets an inheritance? Family. Jesus' royal agenda is to so overwhelmingly communicate to you that he is extending relationship with God to you through this word blessing. He is saying the fellowship with God of the Old Testament has been restored. God's face is shining upon you. He was declaring to you the grace of God through repeating over and over again, blessed, blessed, blessed. He is trying to say your relationship with God has been restored. It comes in many facets. It comes in the form of comfort for those of you who are mourning over the reality of the world. It comes to you in the form of inheriting the whole earth. For those of you who are aware that you've been transparent about your sin, there's going to be a transparency to your inheritance. You will receive the whole world. And it comes in the form of those who have realized they're poor in spirit, those who have repented. The promise of the blessing is nuanced by this idea that they possess the kingdom of heaven. See, this is pure gospel. Jesus coming with good news to his disciples, teaching them about his royal agenda, teaching them about his royal blessing, teaching them to be able to respond when asked the question, how should we respond to the wickedness in the world? We first acknowledge that we contribute to it. We mourn over it. We align our hearts to the very heart of Jesus, the one who weeps when he sees death, who turns over tables when he sees corruption. We mourn over these things. We mourn over the wickedness that is present in our own lives and in the life of the world. And then, of course, here, third, we see this promise that we will inherit the earth. Who? Those who are meek, those who do not disagree when others mourn over our sin. So we see the royal agenda, the royal blessing. We see God's kingdom. We see that it is not about control or lip service or behavior modification. It is about our hearts. And the final question we want to ask as we conclude, as we've meditated on our three verses, we've seen what the kingdom is like. We've seen what the blessing is like. We've seen the promises that come. We've seen the standard that the royal family should hold to. They should be meek. They should be poor in spirit. They should mourn. But we haven't asked, what is this king himself like? Is this mere lip service? Is this mere rhetoric? Is Jesus himself simply offering these words of comfort? And are they empty? What type of king is he? Well, we see that he is a king who, when asked the question, how do you respond to the wickedness in the world? He accepts a crown of thorns on his head. He accepts a robe put on his shoulders. He accepts a reed put in his hand, and he accepts people to offer false worship to him. Jesus, the king, when asked the question, how do you respond to the wickedness in the world, responds by accepting a crown of thorns, by being the king who is mocked, who is spit on, who is beaten. None of this is mere rhetoric for Jesus. He doesn't simply mourn over sin. He dies for it. He doesn't simply look at the poor state of the world's spiritual condition. He dies for it. He doesn't just present himself as meek. He offers himself as both perfect and humble, willing to go silent to the slaughter, one wearing a crown of thorns. When you think about Jesus' agenda, it's most clearly demonstrated in him being mocked and spit on and wearing a crown of thorns. When you think about his royal blessing, know that it came through blood. When he offers you comfort, know that it was costly. When he tells you about his kingdom and that you're a part of his royal family and the inheritance of the whole world, know that the new creation that is launched through him resurrecting from the grave cost him his life. The royal blessing that he speaks as the one who has all authority in heaven and on earth is no cheap comfort, no cheap promise. No, it cost him his very life. And when we contemplate that this is Jesus' royal agenda, to die on behalf of sinners, then when he speaks that word of blessing to us and says, I restored the relationship, you're now back in fellowship with God, we know that it's real. When he says that you will inherit the earth, when he says that the kingdom is yours, when he says comfort, we know that it's costly. He has far more than skin in the game. He has his very life that he offered on our behalf. So how will we respond to wickedness in the world? The only response is to see the most profound wickedness ever, the cross. The most dark hour of the history of the world, the cross. To look at it and see beauty and justice, mercy and justice mingled in such a way that we cannot help but have our hearts moved to think that the Son of God would enter into the darkness to break forth light so that he would have our hearts, our souls, our minds, and our strength. This is no kingdom of behavior modification. Hypocrisy is not wanted in Jesus' kingdom. Instead, he puts himself on display, the cross, that we could see his glory clearly and have our hearts respond with utter allegiance. He will have nothing else. Let's offer it to him today. Let's pray. Gracious God, we rejoice that Jesus demonstrated your love to us, and that while we were still sinners, he died for us. Help us to respond by being poor in spirit. Help us to respond by mourning over sin. Help us to respond by being meek, knowing that our relationship with you has been restored. And we thank Jesus that this is true. And we ask it in his name. Amen.